Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Please take your seats so we can get this session underway. Thank you. Thank you. My name is Yvonne Dege. I'm the moderator for this session. You may also know me as West Africa correspondent for Al Jazeera Television, based in Nigeria. I'd like to welcome everybody to this important launch of Sustainable Energy for All, and this is the decade for Africa. Access to sustainable energy is an essential precondition to achieving many development goals that extend far beyond the energy sector. Sustainable Energy for All, which we are launching for Africa here today, is a global initiative launched by the UN Secretary General, Ban Ki-moon. The initiative aims to be the catalyst for major investments in the energy sector to achieve three objectives: ensuring universal access to energy, doubling the global rate of energy efficiency, doubling the share of renewable energy in the global energy mix. Around 80 governments from around the world have formally engaged with the initiative, and 42 of those governments are here in sub-Saharan Africa. And here today, the African Development Bank acts as host for the launch of the Sustainable Energy for All Africa in partnership with the African Union, NEPAD, and UNDP. And on that note, I would like to invite today's panelists up onto the stage, starting with Dr. Richard Conte, Chief of Staff for the Office of the President of Sierra Leone. Please make your way, Doctor. Thank you, thank you. Followed by Dr. Elham Ibrahim, Commissioner for Infrastructure, African Union Commission. We can do better than that, louder. Let me also welcome Dr. Kandeh Yumkella, who is the Special Representative of the Secretary General on Sustainable Energy for All. Thank you, Dr. Yumkella, for making it. Please take a seat. Excellent. Let me also welcome the Honorable Professor Silas Lwakabamba, Minister of Infrastructure, Government of Rwanda. A warm welcome for him, please. I'd also like to welcome Grace Mukasa, Regional Director, East Africa for Practical Action, a non-governmental organization. Grace, welcome. Please come up on stage. Let me also recognize in the audience Emma Francois Isum Bingabo, Minister of State for Energy and Water, Rwanda. Please stand up so we can see where you are. A warm welcome, please, for Emma. And Mr. Lamine Mane, UN Resident Coordinator for Rwanda. Excellent. Looking forward to a very interesting debate. Access to energy, energy efficiency, renewable energy are all critical to achieving Africa's development goals. 590 million people in sub-Saharan Africa lack access to electricity, 63% of people in urban populations and 86% of people in rural populations. 690 million don't have access to clean and safe cooking facilities. And 19 out of 20 countries with the lowest energy access rates globally are located in sub-Saharan Africa. Energy is the golden thread that connects economic growth, increased social equity, and an environment that allows the world to thrive. It enables water to be pumped for crops and foods and medicines to be refrigerated. Modern fuels for cooking and heating relieve women from the time-consuming drudgery and danger of traveling long distances to gather wood. It enables businesses to grow, generate jobs and create new markets. Children can stay awake to study at dark. Clinics can store life-saving vaccines. Countries can grow more resilient with competitive economies. Countries can build the clean energy economies of the future. Replacing outdated modes of power like cooking stove and open fires could save something like 800,000 lives of children every year who die from inhaling indoor smoke. $34 billion could be saved in household savings, and $105 billion in economic returns could also be harnessed for use. So I want to thank all my panelists for coming today, and we really look forward to an interesting and intimate launch of this all-important occasion and this all-important decade. And I want to start this session by inviting Kandeh Yumkella, the Special Representative of the Secretary General for the Sustainable Energy for All, to present formally and to present the launch of the SE4ALL Decade in Africa. Please, Dr. Kumel, if you could come up to the podium. Thank you so much. A round of applause, please. I understand that you're also going to be introducing a video, so go ahead.
I think we'll have the video a little later. Madam Moderator, Excellencies, Honorable Ministers, Governors of Central Banks, distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, I first of all wish to express our deep gratitude to Donald Kaberuka and the African Development Bank for their support of Sustainable Energy for All. I can also confess here that, in fact, Donald, the moment he took over as president of the African Development Bank, within months, I used to watch him in Europe, he started talking about Africa's need for investments in infrastructure, including energy. So that started even before I started the heavy advocacy on energy issues. I also want to express deep gratitude to the Minister for Energy and Infrastructure and his team here in Rwanda for supporting us to put this side event together. And of course, my partner who has been working with me on this for seven or more years, the Commissioner of Energy and Infrastructure of the African Union. We've been all over the world with our message, whether it's China, India, or elsewhere. But I think our moderator set the tone. She gave you the numbers. Significant energy poverty in our continent. We estimate, we meaning the World Bank and other institutions that are partners of Sustainable Energy for All, that Africa already loses 2 to 3% of GDP every year because of inadequate energy power for the economies. Of course, the social impacts are big, as she has explained. But let me also tell you the good news. In the last 10 days, I have been in four different forums, three different continents, and everybody in those forums is touting the good news about Africa. And one of the interesting good news we heard last week at the World Economic Forum Africa in Abuja was the following. I see my big brother has entered the room. Donald is here. Donald, I'm just doing the introductions till you're ready. But last week in Abuja, there were several sessions on energy, organized by the World Economic Forum and others organized under infrastructure. I estimated roughly 10. And here's some of the good news I heard. I heard that, in fact, 30% of all the new discoveries of oil and gas in the last 5 years were in Africa. In 2012, 9 out of 12 discoveries were in Africa. You know the countries, Mozambique, Tanzania, Uganda, Kenya, Sierra Leone, Liberia, you name it. I also heard that Nigeria, for example, is sitting on 170 trillion cubic feet of gas, 8th largest in the world, but it could even be the 5th largest because they've not even intensified discoveries. So sitting in all of these forums discussing the next 50 years of Africa, which Donald is forcing all of us to reflect on what we want to see in Africa, I said to myself, wait a minute. We were described in one session last week as the darkest continent. It means with all these energy resources, we may not be the darkest continent anymore. In fact, we may be the most prosperous because we have the demographics to show that demographic dividend can kick in. If we have adequate energy, then in fact, we might be leading the third industrial revolution. This is what Sustainable Energy for All is about. It is ensuring universal access to energy. It is ensuring that we improve energy efficiency, and third, deploy massive investments in renewables, because this continent happens to have not only oil and gas, but also hydro, sun, wind, but also biomass. We can be like Brazil, self-sufficient as a continent, but provided we have regional approaches. Countries joining forces to integrate, energy being the integrator. And so this afternoon, in very short order, I give you my proposal. Based on the work Donald and his team have done at the bank and the work done within the regional economic commissions now on the power pools, I am convinced that we need to have two sets of African energy leaders. It is based on a similar model we've used globally. In West Africa, I am convinced If you have the president of Nigeria, Cote d'Ivoire and Ghana forming a coalition with a set of five major businessmen to integrate energy markets between those three, sandwiching the others in the middle. We already have a West Africa gas pipeline. There's not enough gas in it. We don't have enough transmission lines. But I can assure you that under PIDA, under the power pool, a lot of those projects have been designed, but they're not being promoted. They're not in the hands of bankers or investors that can come in. I know some of our African billionaires would love to invest in that. I give you another set. Imagine a future. As Donald says, think about the next 50 years. Imagine a future where Mozambique, Tanzania, Kenya, Uganda form a coalition together with Rwanda and Ethiopia in a similar energy champion group backed by 5 or 10 major African businessmen. I tell you, I have been with some of these businessmen in New York. Aliko Dangote, Tony Olumelo, Shrive Musariwa of Econet, some of the MTN guys. They go to Wall Street and these places to raise real capital for investments. We're not talking charity here. Charity will not transform our energy systems. It is bold leaderships to have the right public policy, as we did for mobile telephony, backed by private investments. Local businessmen with international partners to really create integrated energy markets. My last comment, you might ask me, why are you just selecting a few? My dear friends, the European Union was created for countries looking at steel and coal. Coal because an energy source, steel industry manufacturing. I am convinced that within the regional economic commissions, we look at practical integration for countries that have a vested interest in pooling their energy resources and powering their economies jointly. Then the transmission lines make sense. Then the gas pipelines make sense. What I'm explaining to you is not new, just that we need to scale up. All the estimates show that yes, by 2030, we will still have almost 600 million poor Africans without access to electricity. Why? Because our population would have increased. It is almost like running fast and staying in the same place. We can't afford to do that. Donald, I recognize you when you were not here, but I mentioned that when you took over as president of the bank, some of your very first speeches in Europe at that time, you talked about infrastructure and energy 10 years ago. Fortunately, I came by 3 years later, and I joined you to push this initiative forward. I am convinced, as President Kagame told me last year when I came here to say farewell, that I was stepping down from UNIDO to lead energy global issues. He said to me, they couldn't have found the right man, because you know now, we need energy not just to light the room. We need energy to power industrialization. And yesterday we spent time in the field. The video will explain to you what we did in the field. We tried to humanize energy, to give the courage to African leaders that when you don't have access to energy, you're killing most of your population. You will see in the video the statements from the Minister of Health. I called my colleague, Silas, who put together the mission for us in rural Rwanda yesterday. I said, I was so proud, your education must have worked, because the health minister was explaining energy systems better than Emma and myself. And that's what we're hoping for, that the bank governors and the health ministers and the agriculture ministers recognize that energy is central to Africa's economic development and poverty reduction. Without access to energy, those factories will not work. Without access to energy, we cannot close the digital divide. And I hope that all these new discoveries of oil and gas is not just for LNG. That's the case I was making in Moscow 2 days ago in a meeting chaired by His Excellency Prime Minister Medvedev. That all the discoveries in Africa is not just for LNG exports. How do we use it to power our economy? I hope this session today begins to shine some light on that. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Yumkella. I would like you, I think it's possible from where you're sitting, to introduce this video for us. I'm told for technical reasons, we need to go ahead with the video now. Okay, excellent. So I'll be introducing the video. As you heard Dr. Yumkella talking about a practical example of the impact sustainable energy can have on rural communities. I understand a field visit took place in Rwanda yesterday. So let's roll the video and take a look at some practical examples.
All health facilities, I told you we have 502 health centers. and 45 hospitals across the country. We try to keep geographic equity by giving a health center like this, we would like this, in each sector. And there is around 10 to 17 sector per district.
The minister said, without electricity, you could not reach that level of immunization.
We can say with a good smile that we have the kids the best vaccinate on earth. 10 vaccines for the boys, 11 for the girls. And tetanus for pregnant women who are in need. And we can do that across the country. And we have more than 90% of our kids fully vaccinated, boys for 10 vaccines, girls for 11, because we have had HPV. Meaning all girls from 12 to 16 are vaccinated against HPV. To provide the care, we need electricity. But to use the electricity with economy so that we can also help other sectors, we need to use also solar panel for what we can use. So everything will not be on grid. We will help the development of the country by using electricity with what is absolutely necessary and use solar where we can. What we have shown here is that the health center is exactly almost the same as the other one. Everything is put on waiting for the electrification that we hope to be done within the 2 years. But the difference is the microscope is not connected to electricity. So the efficiency for the technician to do the right diagnostic is not done. Also, even full blood count test is not done. Biochemistry is not done. So there are services the population have to travel a long distance. You see what we did by car? Mm-hmm. They have to do that, to go in line there, to mm-hmm. be registered and do those exams and come back.
Wow.
Huh? Mm-hmm. That means that most of them don't do that. Hmm? And it's a problem. So that means when we have electricity and bring care where the people are in the surrounding environment, where the people are living, the quantity of and quality of care we give is not comparable at all. There is no fridge. We don't have the capacity to keep reagent. There is no light for the woman who deliver at night. It's dangerous. There is a waiting room, that means women who have complicated pregnancy. They cannot stay here because if they deliver at night a complicated pregnancy, we sacrifice, it's dangerous. So we transfer the lady in a health center or in a hospital where there is electricity. But that means somebody of the family have to come to with her. During that time, that adult doesn't work for its own family. There is a loss of income for the family, a loss of something we put in the plate of the child of that person in that family. Mm-hmm. So there is a whole development issue around health and electrification that impact the overall development of the country. Our expectation for this visit is that our energy sector will be supported so that my sector is able to provide better care to the people, to educate them better on use of health facilities, health services, and also to use them better. Hmm? We talked about vaccination, no vaccination program at national level that go deep to serve the people where they live without electricity. We talk about the blood bank, no blood bank without fridge, and no fridge where the people may need, like in a center like this, without electricity. We talk about safe delivery. Delivery occurs so many times when after 6 o'clock. No safe delivery, even with skilled people, without electricity. But there is also something my colleague, Minister Emma, have said about household electricity. I want to tell you that as a Minister of Health, it's so painful to see the number of household accidents due to petrol lamp. when they can, the family will use other source of energy when we can. So support the energy sector, support the energy sector, bring electricity to Africa.
Wonderful, an excellent, profound, simple example of the impact sustainable energy can have on rural health, rural communities in terms of health. And on that note, already recognized by Dr. Yumkella, I want to again welcome President Kaberuka. A round of applause for President Kaberuka of African Development Bank. And President, I want to invite you to the podium, please, to give us some remarks about this initiative. And of course, I have to pose a question as well, so please do come up. A round of applause, please. Nice to see you. The African Development Bank hosts the Sustainable Energy for All Africa Hub. What role will the hub play to help African countries to advance on the Sustainable Energy for All objectives? Please go ahead, sir.
Thank you, and good afternoon. Before I answer your question, moderator, let me begin by thanking you for being here. This is a subject very close to my heart and to everyone in the African Development Bank. And I want to begin by thanking you, Kandeh, for your leadership. I think we found the right person to push this forward, and you are doing your work very well. So well done. I also want to thank the panelists, excellent people who know what they're saying, and I believe we're going to learn a lot from you. I have 3 points to make and answer your question. Just before coming here, we signed off a very big loan for Angola, $1 billion for the power sector in Angola. When in Rio, I promised the candidates we'll put behind this initiative anywhere close to $6 billion. Now, the $1 billion loan to Angola is to achieve two things. It is to reform the power sector in that country, the public utility, the tariff system, the regulators, so that investors can actually now get to producing and transmitting power. That is the starting point. Because I want to say here that now that I've been in the bank for 9 years, there's not enough public money to do these things. We need to mobilize the private sector. Now, it may look difficult at the moment, but if you go back to the 1990s, before the deregulation of the telecom industry, telecom was public sector. There was deregulation, there was reforms, and there was an explosion of the telecom industry. I have no doubt in my mind that it will happen in the power sector as well. So the first thing we do, moderator, is ensuring that you have got regulators that are independent in fact and in law, utilities that function, a tariff system that are socially fair but economically viable. It's an important part of our work because there's no point investing in power in a country when you have got 40% commercial losses or 50% technical losses. That has to be sorted out. That is the first thing we do. We're doing now in Tanzania, when Ghana, we are in, Alex, you can remind me, in Nigeria as well. We've just put in Nigeria about $300 million as partial risk guarantees to ensure that the reform does function. And we're prepared to do this elsewhere as well. The second point I want to make, Kandeh, you said that as well. It is not possible, given the fragmentation of our markets, for each one of our countries to have complete energy security on their own. It would be economically unfeasible. I don't know if some of you know this fact, but Laos exports energy to the tune of $1 billion to Thailand. $1 billion to Thailand. And I think Ethiopia is on the way to be able to export as much power as well. So the second thing we do is to make regional power markets function. Because it is one thing to invest in nationally, but I think enabling the power markets, the power pools across the regions to function is what we do. The third point, if you look at the continent of Africa, I hope I'm right, Silas, you have about 12 or 11 water towers in the Congo Basin, in the Ethiopian highlands, in the Guinea highlands, up in Lesotho, and then along Angola, Zambia, and down to Mozambique, and a few others, in southern Tanzania as well. Now, Kandeh, this is where perhaps what you and I have to think. Even if you put all of those together, including the Nile, including the Zambezi, actually, it will not get us where we should go. People have a habit of saying we have enough hydropower. We actually don't have enough. Even if they are all developed, including Grandinga, we would still not be able to come to the per capita consumption which Africans need. It means we have to develop all sources of power, by the way, including coal. I would like to say here that it's very fine for countries who have enough power at the moment to choose and pick. I think our role would be to say we're going to develop all sources of energy, but we will do it right. Even coal can be done in the right way. So that is something else to do. To enable countries exploit all the resources at their disposal, but do it in the right way, including including coal. So let me end by saying that when the Bolsheviks came to power, these were the guys who took power after the Russian Tsars. They had the aim of going to communism. So they started off building socialism, but they usually had a story that communism was socialism plus electricity. Because they realized that until you have enough power in the country, transformation is not possible. Social transformation, economic transformation. That is the beginning of the beginning. And so I support this initiative. We are housing the hub for Africa. We intend to make it meaningful. And of course, I'm a member of the panel with you, Kandeh, and you can count on my support and that of the African Development Bank. Thank you so much. And I hope I've answered your question.
Yes, you have. Thank you so much. Another round of applause for President Kaberuka, please. Fantastic. Without further ado, I want to now take the conversation further with our distinguished panelists. And I want to start with yourself, Professor Lwakabamba. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. Is that right?
Yeah, correct.
Fantastic. Rwanda is one of the African countries that have said they want to be part of sustainable energy for all. Can you highlight what are the opportunities, but also the concrete and practical challenges that Rwanda faces addressing the issue of energy access, particularly in rural areas?
Yeah, thank you so much, Madam Moderator. Yeah, to us, sustainable energy for all is very exciting because the three objectives are very relevant for us. The issue of increasing access through generating more, through better transmission. The issue of looking at utilization of energy better, more efficiently. The issue of having an energy mix, which is much more renewables. I think it's very critical. Our aim, our commitment as government is really to reach 100% people to access energy. It will take us a bit of time. The aim is to have 70% transmission through from the grid and 30% of the grid solutions. Now, obviously this needs quite a lot of resources, needs a lot of energy, a lot of efforts, and we face a lot of challenges. If you look at the issue of energy generation, we are now around 110 megawatts. Most of this is both mixed, half thermal, more or less half hydro. And then when we try to transmit this, obviously we get into all sorts of problems. We are losing about 23% of our energy through transmission. A bit of study which was done by Mott McDonald showed us that we can, if we invest about $60 million, we can save 15 megawatts of this. Well, this is on transmission alone, but also we know very well that the end user losses are so significant and this can be done. We take an example from one of our brother country who took about $1 million, $1.2 million, and they bought CFLs, and then they gave to the people free, and literally they saved 50 megawatts out of that. That's Zambia, which is has got an installed capacity of 200,000, and I think this is something which we need to aim at. We are trying to do a study on end user losses, and then come up with a proposal to come to that. Definitely the issue of the third objective of using more energy mix of renewables, as I said, half of our generation is mostly based on diesel and heavy fuel, and this is very expensive, very costly. You can not attract investors to buy power at such expensive level. So we really need to generate more from renewables. And for this, we really need to do a mapping out to see the resources we have, for example, in hydro, resources we have in geothermal, the resources we have in methane. We are told that the potential for methane is 350 megawatts in the Lake Kivu. And I think this is also needs to be tapped. We already started and do so many things. But I'm touching on, I can go into details later, but something which is very important, which President Kaberuka touched on, is that we have a group of countries who are working together now. We are five. That is Kenya, Uganda, Rwanda, South Sudan, Burundi has joined, and Tanzania most likely will join very soon. What we are trying to do is that to look at different projects, and one of the major projects in the energy area is generation and transmission. We have got all these projects mapped out and want to be interconnected by 2016 and eventually to Ethiopia by 2015, but eventually to Ethiopia by 2017. And some of us, Kenya, Uganda, and Rwanda, have signed already agreements with Ethiopia to really get this more power from them, which is coming from mostly from hydro. And this will also literally make a difference for us because it was to be less costly and so on. So this is something which I think we believe that sustainable energy for all, like President Kaberuka said, can help us to make sure that the interconnections are done so that we have also the regulatory and the legal frameworks are done properly so that we can trade. And it's quite cheap. It's quite cheap compared to what we are generating now from even from some of our projects. So let me cut there for the time being. I just wanted to connect what Rwanda is trying to do and what's the major aims of sustainable energy for all.
Thank you very much, Prof. Moving from the east of the continent across to the other side, West Africa, Dr. Richard Conte, Chief of Staff, Office of the President, Sierra Leone. What has been your experience? Similar, very different? What are the challenges for you? I think it's working.
Ooh. It's working?
I think so.
Thank you very much. Energy continues to be a major challenge for us in Sierra Leone. We currently have a situation wherein the national electricity access level is as low as 35%, and the national, that's for the urban areas, and then for the national is only 8.2%. The current government installed generation capacity is only about 93.7%. But interestingly enough, what we have discovered is that the private sector, because of the increase in the number of mining companies and other industrial activities, generate up to 356 megawatts. What this means, therefore, is that the situation for our businesses is very abysmal. It's very negative. It makes cost of business very high. Therefore, as a government, we do share the goals of the Energy for All initiative, and we believe that we need to improve on access, efficiency, and we need to double our share of renewable energy in this interesting mix. To take this forward, what government did was to carry out a number of studies primarily aimed at the following. One, to establish exactly what potentials we have, especially in the area of hydropower, and we discovered through the Lamaya study that we have up to 2,000 megawatts hydro potential. We thought of exploring also solar radiation as a source of energy and to complement the seasonality of hydropower, because we all know that hydropower is not at its best in the rainy season. We also explored the use of bioenergy, ethanol, and biofuels to be able to move this process forward. We have tried it out with LPG, especially for domestic purposes, but we have discovered that it is a bit on the high side, especially for the average Sierra Leonean. We are looking at possibilities of converting waste to energy, and we have two projects already ongoing in Freetown and in Bo, the second largest town in Sierra Leone. We are also exploring the possibility of wave energy because of the coastline and the potentials we think exist. However, like the ADB president said, we have realized that these renewable energy possibilities on their own might not serve that purpose. So we are going to have a mix, at least in the medium term, with some large-scale thermal plants using primarily coal and gas. However, we hope we can do it better and make it a bit cleaner. And we are also using biomass. One of our companies, Adax Bioenergy, will pump into the grid about 15 megawatts of power by the end of this year. We do acknowledge, though, that in order to achieve the goals of this Energy for All initiative, government needs to do a number of things. Currently, we have a situation wherein we have up to 40% in technical and commercial losses. That is simply unacceptable. We therefore have to take steps to reduce that. We need to ensure that we introduce more energy efficient technologies, especially using more energy efficient bulbs, and put in place the necessary regulatory regimes to ensure that that is enforced. We need to encourage what they call the use of equipment for power factor correction in our industries and in our homes. We need to promote the development and introduction of improved fuel saving technologies that will replace the firewood, which is currently a source of deforestation. To achieve this, we need to therefore launch a massive awareness campaign, because people need to be taken along. And for them to be taken along, they need to be made fully aware. We need to promote, build our capacities, and promote more efficiencies. This will clearly bring a lot of opportunities for us. It will stimulate our economies. It will improve research. We had the health minister talking about the potentials in the health sector. The same is true for the education sector. It will improve the business environment to reduce the cost of doing business. It will be a catalyst for industry, for small and medium enterprises to grow. And of course, it will create jobs. However, in doing this, we have challenges. Issues of funding, issues of capacity, issues of awareness, issues of coordination, issues of technologies which remain largely inefficient, and of course, the ever-daunting problem of weak institutional arrangements. These are all issues we need to deal with through improved government investments in the sector. We need to blend government finance with concessional finance when necessary, but more importantly, we think the private sector. Mr. Kandeh, I share the views of Kandeh. We need public-private partnerships to be encouraged, where the private sector can come with financing and demand expertise. And we need to also ensure that the necessary government sector policies and reforms and regulatory frameworks are put in place. Let me stop here for now, and I will get into it in a bit more detail as the discussions go on. Thank you very much.
Dr. Kandeh, thank you so much. Let me bring in, and in under 2 minutes, special representative. When you hear those country perspectives, we heard about the Rwanda experience, we heard about the experience in Sierra Leone. Can you give us a sense of how you see the Sustainable Energy for All initiative evolving and influencing the outcomes in these nations with practical examples in under 2 minutes, please? Yeah.
First of all, we're encouraging each of those countries to develop their action agenda. The targets are clear. Some of the numbers shown by the two ministers fit within that framework. We have clear targets by 2030. What can you do nationally to achieve them? What are the building blocks? Also identifying some of the obstacles or barriers that need to be removed. And what we do then through our regional development bank partner, which is the hub, the African Development Bank, is to provide the necessary technical support to help them establish that long-term vision, the public policy changes for energy governance within the sector. Donald emphasized that a lot. If you have a loss-making utility, there's no way any private sector will be interested. Mm. If you cannot boldly deal with the issue of energy pricing, no private sector will come in. So public policy is crucial. The deregulation and bundling of the sector is crucial. So with the World Bank and the African Development Bank and other partners, we want to help with that issue of public policy and governance. The second support we want to give is what we call development of the investment prospectuses. Some countries want to invest more in rural electrification. Some others, like Ghana, say we don't need help with rural electrification. Our biggest headache now is cooking solutions. Mm-hmm. So Ghana is more focused, for example, on cooking solutions. How do we develop an investment plan for them that will, in fact, crowd in private investment? So first help, establishing the vision till 2030, supporting them with technical assistance for the public sector reforms they need to put in place. And third, the investment prospectuses. And of course, linking them with the financing. And some of that work is already ongoing with a few of them.
Great, you have to let us know responses to what you're doing. At this stage, I'd like to bring in Dr. Elham Ibrahim, who's the Commissioner for Infrastructure at the African Union Commission for a more continental perspective. What is your reaction to what you've heard so far, and how can cross-sectoral and cross-country dialogue, which is what your organization is about, encourage further engagement on the issue of sustainable energy for all?
Okay, thank you very much. I really appreciate what Dr. Yumkella mentioned about what they are doing on the country level, but on the continental level, I think it is the real role of the African Union as a continental body for all development and even political issues. In the area of energy, I think it's clear for most of us that the African Union, together with the African Development Bank, our real partner, and together with NEPAD, we developed for the first time the Program for Infrastructure Development in Africa, PIDA. And Dr. Yumkella had mentioned that, and I'm sure that Mr. Kaberuka, also one of his sons, is this program. And I'm proudly saying that we started the implementation of this program, which includes four sectors. One of them is the energy, where we are concerned with the regional and continental projects in the energy sector, the same as the other three sectors. For energy specifically, there are 15 projects for the period up to 2020. Nine of them is generation, especially in hydropower. And we have four projects for interconnection. And I think this comes with what we were mentioning on working on the continent, in the regional and continental level. Because as we all know, we have some points where we have a lot of resources. At the same time, there are the consumption pools are not in the same place. So interconnection is essential. Interconnection not only for electricity, but also for oil and gas. And we have also two projects within these 15 projects in oil and gas pipelines. So this is one of the areas that the African Union had played a role. And now we can see the private sector show their interest to invest and work in this sector of energy specifically. This needs from us as the continental organization to do something, to build the capacity of our member states, of our regional organizations, I mean the regional economic communities, the NEPAD Planning and Coordination Unit, and we already started this action we got support from GIZ and from ADB to build the capacity technically for these bodies. I mean, the RECs and NEPAD, and even we will go to the member states. That's why to be able and capable to implement those regional projects. As I think it was mentioned many times that one of the areas we need is to build our capacities. If there is time, I can mention some other examples, successful examples in the region of in the area of energy. It's the geothermal risk mitigation facility. I consider it really a success story for the African Union with support of our partners, where we created a facility which can support the developers of geothermal energy. And it is especially in the Rift Valley region where the potential is very high, but it can be expanded later. So what we do in this project, we support the developers in two or three activities, the surface studies and the drilling process where the risk is very high, and we succeeded to have for now three contracts signed with some developers in Ethiopia and Kenya. There are 16 projects now under evaluation to see which of them is ready to get this support in this area. I think we have a lot of successful or programs, like, for example, the solar energy. We are studying how we can make use of our Sahara in Africa, where we can use this solar energy in production of electricity. The bioenergy, where it is, I think that in many forests and many countries, the issue of bioenergy is discussed, some supporting, some against. That's why we prepared, together with the UNECA, guidelines and framework for bioenergy in the continent, and we succeeded to do that. I don't know if I can stop here, but I have a lot.
Because I can see you have many examples of some of the successful work that's being done, but it is very helpful and useful to hear about some of the specific projects and your success with them. So keep up the good work on that. Let me bring in Grace Mukasa now, who's the Regional Director for East Africa for Practical Action, which I would describe as the civil society arm of this issue. The first 2 years of the Sustainable Energy for Decade have a particular emphasis, Grace, on the nexus between energy, women, children, and health. From your experience, can you elaborate for the panelists and for the audience on this nexus and let us know what your thoughts are on the solutions, which solutions should be promoted to reach many rural areas without energy success? And please keep it to 3 minutes. I realize we're really running out of time and we still have some more interventions from the floor to come. So please go ahead, Grace.
Yeah, mine was to elaborate on the link between energy and people.
That's right.
Where we say energy is not an end in itself. We want to see results, especially on the poorest people.
Yeah.
And we are saying that really we need to have total energy access, especially at household level. We need the energy for cooking, for lighting, for heating, for ICT and productive use. We want to go beyond the lighting because most people focus on lighting and they say we have access to energy. So it's going beyond that. We want to look at energy at household level. Mm-hmm. We want to look at energy for productive use of the people and the community services that really serve us, like schools, the health centers, and so on. Mm-hmm. That's how we shall measure success and say it has made a difference. We want to look at the gendered dimensions of energy. As we know in Africa, majority of our people are using biomass energy for cooking. and it has negative impacts, especially for women and children who spend a lot of time in the kitchen, which is really not clear, and using solid energy, the stoves are not efficient. So indoor air pollution and the annual death of so many mothers.
Something like 800,000, right?
Is really worrying, yeah. Then we are looking at how energy can be an enabler, especially for women who have huge workloads, collecting firewood for cooking and losing out on other productive activities, affecting girls' education as they go to look for it. But we also know women are so much into the informal sector. They can be users of energy, but also be involved in the supply of energy. So the small and micro enterprises need to be looked at. We all know small-scale farmers are really, you know, holding Africa in terms of food security, and women dominate that sector also. So as we think of all the policies and the initiatives, we should see how to invest in those areas. And of course, community services, emergency obstetric care, why are we losing so many mothers every year? Children emergencies, you know, children with malaria, with measles and so on, who require energy to be in that healthy center, but it doesn't happen. And I also would like us to look at the role of civil society. Sustainable energy for all emphasizes the three pillars: government, private sector, and civil society. But it's important to always recognize the role of civil society, to participate in the issues that affect the people, and really work with them to mobilize and organize communities for, you know, technology uptake, for really building businesses, and not forgetting that they need to continue with their role for advocacy. And advocacy needs to be financed. So in terms of the things we look at, we are also very interested in what is happening in the rural areas, especially, and even other urban areas, for people who are not on the grid. Investing there, I think the majority of the people would really benefit if we invested in a decentralized energy. We really addressed the barriers. So overall, we are looking at the policies that really open up. We are looking at financing for different types of energies, and we really look at capacity building, including capacity of the communities themselves and civil society. That's my take.
Grace, thank you so much. Dr. Yumkella, has the role of civil society been undervalued or underplayed? Has it been incorporated sufficiently enough?
We have incorporated it significantly. In the past 2 years, we've registered 1,600 what we call practitioners in a database now managed for us in Washington. We know the names, the addresses of those NGOs and social entrepreneurs. In fact, on the 4th of June, we're hosting a civil society full day discussion on energy. What is significant here is a number of them are not NGOs that are specialized in energy, but they have been groups as they try to promote health, food security, or water security, suddenly recognize the centrality of energy, or in fact, as they even do humanitarian relief work. So for example, NGOs tell us that more rapes of women and children and girls occur in refugee camps when they step out to collect firewood or water. We know from NGOs, the issue Grace raised very eloquently on the economic empowerment of women. You can look at studies in Africa. For some commodities, 90% of the processing of food is done by women, not to mention the marketing. And so when we say energy here in a holistic sense, we have to look at mechanical energy as well to empower women. But one of the things she also stressed, the women and girls on average globally, we've calculated for developing countries, 20 hours a week collecting firewood and water. Imagine if that can be made available, how much you can unleash into the workplace. I always say to Westerners, think about what the microwave clothes washing machine and dishwashing machine did after World War II for women in OECD and the Western world. They just went into the workforce because they were relieved. We're not asking for a wash machine in my village in Sierra Leone, but we're just saying, look, there are basic technologies today that can really relieve that energy plus also assist them in the major part of agribusiness, the supply chain.
Dr. Yumkella, thank you so much. We are running out of time. We've got about 20 minutes left. And on that note, I do want to now turn to the floor to all of you who've been patiently listening. I'm sure you're all dying to intervene and ask a few questions. Let me first start with Emma Francois Isumbingabo, the Minister of State. If we can get a microphone to the Minister of State for Energy and Water here in Rwanda. What do you think about what you've heard, Honourable Minister? Can we get a microphone? There you go. Please stand so you can be seen.
I think all have been said. In order to bring development, sustainable development, and also reduce the poverty, the energy is the central player. So it affects, of course, the development, social, environmental, and economic. Yesterday, we have seen it, how it impacts in the health sector, and it also impacts in agriculture to bring access to water and to get people, you know, graduate from a level to another socially, to bring good education, and gender-related issues, to resolve some gender-related issues. It's very important that while we think about infrastructure, we also think about how this energy we're thinking about can be affordable. How is it going to be reliable? And how is it going to be commercial viable? That's why I support my minister there, bringing some of the challenges that the Rwandan sector has. Mm. The first of all is to have some legal and regulatory frameworks that are strong. The utility that has a positive balance sheet so that the private sector is confident doing business with that utility instead of keeping asking for sovereign guarantee of a country that when you think about countries in this region, they are not ready to offer sovereign guarantees to all private sector players in the energy sector, mainly that we want to bring to 1,000 of megawatts. So if every 10 megawatts need a sovereign guarantee, that we are not going to get there. Secondly, we also need to have stronger financial or fund mobilization strategies. First of all, we provide incentives to our private sector. And as we also try to see how we can eliminate or mitigate risks before they get into the play. I give the example, geothermal. The geothermal sector is quite risky. There are some activity to be taken up front, example, exploration drilling. We need, as a government, to put some, to try and reduce the risk for the private sector to join, because I'm quite confident they cannot come when they can see it's an exploration. Mm. It's not yet proved. Another thing that we really need to look into is the capacity, required skills. Because if all that we talk about, those nice policies, strategies, yes. how to put together a good business model, if we don't have capacity, we'll never reach there. So capacity building is also at the heart of what we need to tackle at the moment so that we can provide affordable, reliable, and available energy to our people. I thank you.
Thank you so much. A round of applause, please, for the Minister of State. Thank you so much. And let me invite Mr. Lamine Mane, UN Resident Coordinator for Rwanda here, to also share his perspective. And then after that, we have a practical example from Mobisol coming up. So, Mr. Mane, UN Resident Coordinator here, what is your sense of what you've heard and how do we thread all of this together for effective improvement in sustainable energy for all?
Thank you very much, Madam Moderator. You know, we have many visitors here, so I'm just going to contribute for their learning a little bit of Kenya Rwanda. Murakoze Shane, that means thank you very much. And then Mirwe is good afternoon. So at least you should go with those two expressions. So thank you very much, Madam Moderator. Let me say how much I feel privileged to stand in for my colleagues who were supposed to be here from both New York and the Regional Service Center. So at the last minute, they had other engagements and they could not be here. I would also like to thank Dr. Yumkella and to commend his energy and the passion for this very important initiative. So I think it's also in order to thank the African Union. This is the leadership, the continental leadership, that the leadership we are providing to the continent in many initiatives. For UNDP, we see this as a very important initiative, sustainable energy for all. I think one question that has not been raised or answered is, why do we aspire for sustainable energy for all? I think in simple terms, energy is very important, it's lifeblood, blood for life. For UNDP, as you know, a major philosophy we have been advocating for over 20 years is for everybody to lead productive, healthy, and long lives. So we see that as very consistent with this noble objective. I think the point has been made that in the earlier years, we saw energy generation as purely economic activity. Generation of energy was done mainly through centralized power generation and distribution. This, of course, has contributed to the growth in many countries. One could cite countries like Zambia and Zimbabwe, whose industrialization was powered by the cheap hydropower generated at Kariba. They have benefited from centralized generation of power. But again, as Dr. Yumkella has said, and you have seen this from the video, the Minister of Health has rightly said that in order to address some of the other development issues, like health, particularly in the rural areas, we have to have a resort to decentralized power generation. So, Madam Moderator, distinguished panelists, for UNDP, this is what we see as of paramount importance with respect to this initiative. And actually, UNDP has been engaged in promoting decentralized, off-grid, cost-effective power generation. I was in charge of programs when I was in New York about 14 years ago. But what we want to do now in UNDP is to leverage the Sustainable Energy for All initiative to work with the other partners in mainstreaming the tremendous experience we have gained in the national planning processes to meet both the growth objectives of the continent as well as transformation. Dr. Kaberuka alluded to that. Africa cannot be transformed without adequate power. But also we have to use decentralized energy generation to address poverty issues. So from that perspective, we within UNDP, we welcome this initiative and we are key partners. We have already worked with the UN Secretary General's Secretariat, which is headed by Dr. Yumkella. We have been working with the African Development Bank, the World Bank, at the AU in setting up the hub. which is based at the African Development Bank, and we are now working on the plans to help all the countries using our decentralized country offices to help them to integrate effectively the decentralized approach to development and power generation. Of course, the conclusion is that I would like to make is that we in UNDP, we don't see the two objectives, that is generation of power through centralized systems and decentralized generation of power as mutually exclusive. So we are ready to help the countries to marry the two within their planning processes. Thank you.
Thank you. A round of applause for Mr. Mane. Thank you so much for that. Just a few minutes left, but very important to talk about practical examples of how sustainable energy can work for ordinary people. And I want to invite to give a very brief presentation, Mr. Gottschall, I hope I got that right, probably not, from Mobisol, to present a practical example of electrification of the poor in Rwanda. After that, we will open up the floor for just two or three questions, because there is another session coming into this room afterwards. So please, can I hand over to you, Mr. Gottschall? Thank you. A round of applause, please, for him.
What a cause. Mirebe, I'm Akuro. I have a challenge. I only have 5 minutes to give you an introduction to a solution for 1.5 billion people. The presentation should come in now, I hope. There it is. I will make it as brief as possible. If you have questions, we will be here after the event, so please don't hesitate. Mobisol started in a two-people company in 2010, and has developed over that time. By now, we have more than 200 people working for us in Africa, in Europe, in China, and we have electrified more than 4,000 households. And received quite an okay amount of money to do our work. 2013, we installed around 3,000 systems in Tanzania. There will be another 15,000 coming in this year. We are planning to have 5,000 systems installed in Rwanda this year. What did we do? What makes Mobisol so special? We did not invite the sun. We did not invite the solar panel. What we invented is a Mobisol controller. The Mobisol controller is equipped with a GSM modem, like a little mobile phone. And this is communicating via the GSM network, via the mobile network, to our database. What we have done is we have implemented mobile money into our service. So all of our systems are pre-financed. So if you are living in a rural place in Rwanda and you don't have the $1,000 to pay for a solar home system up front, you can come to us and you pay around $15 per month. And this is collected via mobile money received by the database, and we can lock the system if the customer does not pay. So that's our possibility to make sure that the investment we do is secure. So in a nutshell, we offer 24/7 remote monitoring to our systems. We offer a 3 years guarantee to all of our systems. We have a microfinance approach to make sure that the people can afford it, because affordability in the end is the most important part. If something breaks down within 48 hours, we come. There's a free installation. And if you compare it to the grid with the same convenience the grid offers you, it's only 35% of the cost. What I believe is the grid seems to be 80s for most of the needs of the rural population. Energy is produced where it is consumed, so on the roof of the houses of the people in rural countryside. 365 is a very important number for us. That means we offer reliable energy supply 365 days a year. So it is a solution which is as good as a grid, maybe even better because it is more reliable. That's our an overview about the systems. So the basic system offers you light, mobile phone charging and radio. The biggest system is actually an SME system. So 1/3 of our customers, more than 1,000 customers, are using a Mobisol system to earn additional income to, improve their lifestyle. 60 is another important number for us. It takes 60 minutes to install one Mobisol solar home system. So within 60 minutes, one household is electrified. I will come back to that number a little later. What did we do in Rwanda? We started our operations in January 2014. We have more than 50 people working for us, and we are planning to have another 120 joining the team. That's where we are. That's the systems we have installed so far. There was one more system joining yesterday that was at the clinic. And Mobiso donated a 200-watt system to the health center, which is replacing the diesel generator. So we see a mitigation of CO2 of around 2 tons per year. And the clinic is saving 40% in its cost. So no or less diesel consumption for that clinic. So again, that makes Mobiso unique. What we can offer is a remote monitoring. You see the yellow curve is the sunshine. The green curve is the battery state. The red curve is what the system is consuming. So the red, that is a system we installed yesterday. So basically you can see at around 10 o'clock we started the installation, and what you can see, beautifully enough, at 9 o'clock on the right side, there must be an accident or there must be need in the clinic for light. So you can see the red line goes from zero to the negative place, and we can see that there was energy consumption happening yesterday night already at the clinic, improving the life of the people. That was a very interesting news we received a few weeks ago. We're doing a project together with IWASA and together with the EU to electrify 50,000 households. Actually, it is 49,000 households and 1,000 schools. It's a total budget of $30 million, and yeah, we are keen to start that as soon as possible to get the electrification out. The minister mentioned capacity building is the most important one, and actually that's what we figured out as well. Our biggest bottleneck is not financing. Financing is nice to have. It's not the technology. Technology is there. But what is the biggest headache for us is capacity building, to have the people on the ground who can run the business as it is needed to be sustainable. So what we did, we founded the Mobiso Academy, education made in Germany, which is currently training 25 youth per week, and can be extended to around 50 people every week. Very important is if you qualify in that academy, you get a job guarantee, actually. So you can earn an additional income, or you can make a living from being a Mobiso person. What does it need? It's an empty piece of paper. I would like to get that now back to you into the discussion. What does it need, actually? How long does it take to install maybe around 1 million systems, which is needed to have 100% electrification in Rwanda? So a house, 1 million households, if we have 500 technicians, and we have at the moment 50 technicians at Mobiso, so it's not that far to have 500. It takes 2,000 systems per technician. Since a technician only needs 1 hour to install, we say one technician can install 4 Mobiso systems per day, which makes 1 million solar home system installed within 500 days. So that is a solution which can bring power to the people living off the grid. You can see Mobiso Live. We have an inauguration on Thursday, the 22nd of May, in Yamata, where you can see what is happening on the ground. So another little phrase for you, Baiba Ubukene. Why do I believe in Baiba Ubukene? The gentleman meant that with energy, it starts. It's a first step for people to develop. And obviously, they don't receive a check from us, but they receive the possibility to earn income, to have the kids study at night, to improve their lives. So that's the message from Mobiso. Baiba Ubukene means translated, bye-bye poverty. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Excellent presentation, and really fantastic to hear the practical example. I had hoped to take two or three questions from the floor, which I'm told I can do. There is a group of people waiting to get in here. So just two or three interventions or questions from the floor for our panelists. 10-second question, 30-second answer, 60-second roundup of each person, and we're out of here. So interventions from the floor. Anybody want to pose a question? Okay, there's a gentleman there. Please stand up, say who you are, and please pose your question. And whoever's next, please get ready and get the attention of somebody holding a microphone. Please go ahead, sir.
Thank you very much. My name is Tue Christiansen from the Danish Minister of Foreign Affairs. I just want to, first of all, congratulate you for so far you've come with this initiative. Denmark has been supporting the African Development Bank and this hub through our bilateral funding. And it's nice to see you've come so far. The point I'd like to make is that as a donor representative, I think we have reached the nexus, or we as donors should also see this in a different perspective now. We have provided donor funding to that extent, and we'll of course continue to do so. It is important. However, we can also assist in facilitating contacts to private sector investors, pension funds, people who want to invest in Africa in secure long-term funding. And why here today, I think there's scope of work here for us, working together in that particular area, and I really welcome that. We're going to host a conference in Copenhagen in June where we'll bring this issue. We're working with African Development Bank on this particular thing to bring this issue to the table. And just 3 points, if you allow me, Madam Chair. What we need from the bank and what we from the African side is to see projects that have been exposed to due diligence. We need innovative financing solutions that our potential investors will find acceptable. And then we need the capacity of the African Development Bank to broker the right deals. That is also important. If you can broker the deals and do the other things, we can also convey the contacts to the potential investors, and they are there. I think the rate of return in Africa is much higher than in Europe these days. So let's take this opportunity and take it forward. I think this is a very important thing. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. One more intervention or two from the floor. Does anybody want to pose a question or have some remarks they want to make? Searching, yes, I can see one person there. Yeah, please stand up, state your name and who your question is for. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm Dr. Kaba. I'm the Secretary General of Mano River Union, based in Sierra Leone. It is an intergovernmental organization comprising Côte d'Ivoire, Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea. I would like to say hello to Dr. Yumkella. I met some 1 year ago in Vienna. And I think all panelists for the inspiring ideas. I'm the Secretary General of an organization concerned about how we can introduce all these initiatives in the educational system. I have a group of women in Sierra Leone. We call them barefoot women. They have been trained in India on how to put in place solar plants. And they are illiterate. They really, now they are doing lamps and solar plants for many houses. How Dr. Yumkella, but also African Union and other agencies can help us to spread this experience in West Africa, where we have solar energy for free, thanks God, all the time. But how to go from talking to action? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Madam. Dr. Yumkella, if you could briefly answer that question. We'll take one more question, then wrap up.
Indeed, we collaborated with our friends in Sierra Leone and also the government in establishing the Barefoot College with support from India. We believe it was a practical experience there that can be replicated in many countries. Bonka Roy, who is the promoter of that idea of the Barefoot College for illiterate women in communities to be energy engineers, is still willing. Of course, we're now trying to see how we mobilize additional financing from some of the donors, but also the governments. I encourage governments, I think the solution that Mobisol presented, or the case of Barefoot College, I say to African leaders, look, this does not require $10 million. The cost of paying for a few people to go to conferences can electrify a community quick. We know the costs. Mm-hmm. So my point is, as we seek, we're approaching the top-down approach, the big projects, big transformative power generation, transmission lines. But I think what Mobisol and my sister from Mano River Union is saying, you have these practical solutions today that governments themselves can write the checks. If they have the right public policy as well, their own young people, youth, can pick these initiatives and run with it. So part of what we're going to do, our main discussion in New York in about a few weeks, is to see how we can finance that bottom of the pyramid solution. Simple, quick solutions that make people have power in their communities real time, now, today, not tomorrow. You don't need advanced technologies for that. Of course, for the big power generation, for industrialization, we need big finance. So some of these can be done by governments. They can be done by some rich folks in their own countries to help their communities, empower them, and improve their economic, their productivity and economic standing in society. So we'll do both top-down and bottom-up approaches.
Thank you so much. Final question, the very last question from the floor, if there is one. I don't see anybody's hand up. Oh, yes, just one gentleman there. Final question from you, please, sir. Please state your name, your organization, and who you're posing your question to.
My name is Dabire. I'm the Director of Energy of ECOWAS Commission. My question is about regional projects. We are now come to the conclusion that we have to finance regional power plants. The scheme we did for a project like the Cote d'Ivoire, Liberia, Sierra Leone interconnection projects, it's a regional interconnection project, 1,300 kilometers line. But if you take the finance structure, you come up, it's like it's financed by the member states from their loans, from their grants, from the institutions. So how can we come up with regional line of credits, regional finance for regional projects, instead of still having, like for AdB, you'll have more national provisions and things like that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And who is that question to, please? Is that question for a specific panelist?
I can.
You can answer that. Okay, Dr. Ibrahim, yeah, please, yeah. Very briefly. Yeah. I see the next moderator for the next session is right here, so I'm feeling the pressure now. Okay. Let's go for it.
I think, as you mentioned, you are the director of ECOWAS, so you know how far we are dealing with this issue. But for now, it is not possible, as there should be somebody responsible for these loans we got. But it is under processing to see how we can get this, we can call it a unit for a specific project to be responsible for all these issues of starting from financing to building, construction, and also operation and maintenance. Yes, it will come, but we have to work together as we are doing for now. Thank you.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to mention something to our Danish representative about financing or presenting some projects for investment. I may announce that we will have next month, 14 and 15 of June in Dakar, what we call Dakar Finance Summit, where there are specific projects that are ready for implementation. It will be presented for investors from everywhere, and I think this will be a good opportunity for all interested partners and investors to come and share with us what we have and what we want to do. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So I'm told that we are completely out of time now. I had hoped to go to closing remarks from everybody. I'll take the last remark from Dr. Yumkella, please, in 60 seconds, and then bid you all farewell.
60 seconds.
Less than.
Join us in the Sustainable Energy for All campaign. Help us get governments to do the right public policies in Africa to do for the energy sector what they did for the mobile telephony. Africans are ready to leapfrog. African investors are also ready to put cash on the table. Deregulate, unbundle, create incentives, cash will come.
Thank you, Dr. Yumkella. Can I have a round of applause for the panelists? Dr. Richard Conte, Chief of Staff, President of Sierra Leone's office. Dr. Elham Ibrahim, Commissioner of Infrastructure, African Union Commission. Dr. Kandeh Yumkella, who you just heard there, Special Rep for the SecGen on Sustainable Energy for All. And Grace Mukasa, Regional Director for East Africa Practical Action, and of course, the Honorable Minister of Infrastructure for Rwanda. Thank you so much. And the interventions from the floor, from the Minister of State for Energy and Water, Emma Isumbingabo, and Mr. Lamine Mane, UN Resident Coordinator for Rwanda. Now, I've been told to place an advertisement for the next session in this room. as payback for running over time a little bit. The next session is accountability and transparency, one of my favorite topics. You may want to stay around for that. The moderator is the esteemed Mr. Jeff Kwanyange, who's right to my right-hand side, and the rapporteur is Mr. Sekou Touré, Director of Compliance, Review and Mediation for the African Development Bank. So that's what's happening in this room, so please stay put. Thank you, everybody.